to say a word about what these official histories are. I mean, it's a government program, sadly, as a result of the cuts coming to its conclusion. And their official histories have already been written and are being written on a number of issues. And the idea is that you get people to go through the government archives, not to try and do kind of retrospective spin on decisions that were taken many moons ago, but to try and tell the story using the documents and the thinking of people at the time. Why did these guys do what they did? What motivated them to take the decisions that they did? The first volume of the official history of Britain and the European Community, going from the end of World War II up until 1963, which was when France's President de Gaulle cast his first veto on a British application to join the European Community, was done by Professor Alan Millwood, sadly now dead, and I was asked then to do the second volume, which goes from that same veto by de Gaulle up to 1975, when the then British Prime Minister, Harold Wilson, held a referendum on whether Britain should remain in the European Community, and the result of that was a two-thirds majority of the electorate that Britain should stay in. And some of it's quite germane because, as we know, we're faced with a situation where there is likely to be, the Prime Minister's already pretty much promised it, a referendum on whether the terms on which Britain stays in the now European Union sometime in the next Parliament. I start really with I won't go back to the factors which led Harold Macmillan, the then British Prime Minister, 4 years after Britain decided not to join with others in the original European Community at the Treaty of Rome. Not so much the decision which led him to, or the factors which led him to change his mind, but to go to the end of 1962, beginning of 1963, when Britain's negotiations to accede to a European Community, of which there were already six member states, were coming towards, as Britain hoped, coming towards a conclusion. But in January 1963, de Gaulle gave a press conference in which he said, in classic de Gaulle terms, magisterially and offensively at the same time, that there was no way that Britain was capable of joining the European Community. And that was the end of the hopes and aspirations of the Macmillan government, and perhaps the beginning of the end as far as Macmillan himself was concerned, because he resigned from office later in that year. Later in his life, Macmillan, talking to his official biographer, said, "If Hitler had danced in Whitehall, we'd have had no trouble with de Gaulle," by which he meant that the reason, the motivation behind de Gaulle's veto was de Gaulle's feeling of resentment at the humiliations which he, as leader of the Free French, had suffered at the hands of Britain, Churchill, and Roosevelt, President of the United States. Now, if we were going down that route, I would argue that the positions of Britain and the United States were actually, vis-a-vis de Gaulle, were actually very different, not least because it was Britain that harbored de Gaulle when he made his famous speech in London calling the French people to arms, and it was the United States government, not the British government, that continued to recognize the Vichy government of occupied France up until 1944. But be that as it may, that was certainly what Macmillan said in later life, was certainly one aspect of de Gaulle's position. But not the only one. There was hard-headed calculation on de Gaulle's part. De Gaulle had returned to power in France in 1958, a year after the conclusion of the Treaty of Rome. So he'd had no part in its negotiation and strongly disliked the institutional supranational structures, the European Commission, the European Court, an embryo, European Parliament, all those things he disliked. But he shrewdly recognized that the basic structure of the European Community was one that would serve France's interests. First of all, it was a vehicle for reconciliation between France and Germany, and through that reconciliation, a means of for France of containing what they still feared was the power of Germany and the danger of a resurgence of aggressive German intentions that had been seen from the War of 1870 through the First World War and the Second World War, of which France had been a particular victim. But he also saw in a customs union, which was designed as a protectionist organization, a vehicle for the advancement of France's economic interests. After all, you had a system whereby goods could circulate freely within the customs union, but imports into it were subject to a high tariff, and France, as the major agricultural producer of the European community, that created a situation which was advantageous to French, to the French economy, heavily based on agriculture at the time. And with a budget of the European community 90% and more devoted to financing of the common agricultural policy, this clearly was an advantage. And de Gaulle saw that if Britain joined, things would radically change. About a week before the press conference at which de Gaulle cast his veto, the then French agriculture minister bumped into the British agriculture minister, Christopher Soames, Winston Churchill's son-in-law, at a meeting, and said, well, at the moment, it's great from France's point of view. There's a dunghill, and there's one cockerel on top of the dunghill. And we're the, and, you know, de Gaulle is the cockerel. If there are two cockerels on the dunghill, i.e. if Britain comes in, c'est pas aussi amusant, not such fun. So he kind of predicted, and that also was an aspect of it, because what de Gaulle saw was, first of all, that Britain is the world's biggest importer of agricultural produce, mostly coming from the British Commonwealth, would find it extremely difficult to adhere to the rules of community preference, i.e. buying its agricultural produce from within the European community. It would be much harder to maintain the European community as a protectionist organization, and that clearly Britain, with its Atlantic vocation, its relationship with the United States, its dedication to NATO, would make it very difficult for de Gaulle to continue with what he wanted to build, which was a European identity not in hostility to the United States, but certainly built independent of and in contradistinction to the United States. One reason why de Gaulle attached so much importance to the development of an independent French nuclear deterrent, and why he always regarded, as did his successor Pompidou, the possibility of nuclear collaboration with Britain as a non-starter, because he saw the British nuclear deterrent as being controlled effectively by the United States. So there were some hard-headed reasons behind de Gaulle's veto. But it left Macmillan high and dry in terms of policy. There was nowhere else to go, because Macmillan had rightly worked out, and this too is a feature of the Macmillan period, the Wilson period that followed it, and then the period of Edward Heath, when Britain joined the European community. Macmillan had rightly calculated that both economically and politically there was nowhere else for Britain to go other than membership of the European community. Before the signature of the Treaty of Rome, Britain's trade had been massively greater with the countries of the Commonwealth and with the United States than with those countries that were to form the European community. By the time we're talking about, that had radically shifted. Britain's trade with the European community was much more important, suffering, of course, because we had to pay the tariffs which the common market had set up. And politically, what Macmillan saw, as others did, was that for the rest of the 20th century, there would be two superpowers, the United States on the one hand and the Soviet Union on the other. The rise of China was foreseen, but in indeterminate terms, not surprisingly. The economic rise of Japan was not at that stage foreseen. And as far as the Soviet Union was concerned, nobody either then or even very much later into the 1980s foresaw the demise of the Soviet Union that we all now know. So what was Britain, which was no longer a superpower? How was Britain going to exercise influence in the world? And the politics were as important, if not more important, than the economics. So after de Gaulle's veto, a year, Macmillan had gone by the autumn of 63, Alec d'Aubusson, his successor, was unable, even if he wanted to make any progress politically on Europe, not least because, of course, British public opinion felt humiliated by, here was the man, de Gaulle, who we felt that we had kind of saved. We felt that we had saved France, rightly or wrongly, in World War II. Here was he turning against us. I was 16 years old when the veto was cast, and I can remember that sense of kind of anger and humiliation and frustration. So there was no way politically that a British government, even if de Gaulle had been more amenable, could revive at that point an effort to join the Iberian community. And so when Harold Wilson and the Labour Party won a narrow victory, very narrow victory, in the October 1964 election, they came in with no commitment to seek to join the European community. They had, in opposition, criticised not the idea of joining, but the terms which the Conservative government were negotiating as being disadvantageous to the Commonwealth, disadvantageous to the British economy. But Wilson himself was not hostile to the European idea. He never took the position which his predecessor as leader of the Labour Party, Hugh Gaitskell, had taken. Gaitskell's famous speech that joining the European community would be the end of 1,000 years of history. Indeed, the speech which Wilson, as Shadow Chancellor, made when the Conservative government applied to join is an interesting one, because what Wilson had to say about sovereignty is not something I think you would hear from many British politicians today. Wilson said in the House of Commons, and consistently repeated it through the rest of his political career, that in his view, the erosion of sovereignty, far from being a bad thing, was a mark of civilizing influence in international affairs. But what Wilson saw coming into office, and coming into office in very difficult economic circumstances domestically, was that the best way to go would be for Britain to build up its relationships with those countries with whom it was in partnership in the European free trade area, free trade association, largely a kind of Nordic free trade zone, and possibly to have some kind of merger between EFTA on the one hand and the EEC on the other. Two things kiboshed that from the start. One was that at no point were the members of the European community interested. They were much larger already and more prosperous than EFTA. And secondly, because of the dire economic straits which Wilson found himself in, he imposed a tariff on imports from EFTA, which was illegal in terms of the EFTA treaty and almost brought the organization to an end. And within a short space of time, pressures were building within the British government from George Brown, who was Wilson's deputy and a long-standing pro-European, and from Michael Stewart, the new Foreign Secretary, to reconsider whether, after all, Britain's place didn't lie within the European community. And over a period running through 1965 up to and beyond the general election of 1966, where Wilson dramatically increased his majority and therefore his parliamentary strength and his, to an extent, his freedom of maneuver, Wilson was gradually moving towards a position in which he began to consider that, yes, indeed, membership of the European community was the way that Britain ought to go. But he played it long, and it wasn't until later in 1966 that at a special cabinet that he called Chequers one Saturday, that he got his colleagues in cabinet to agree that he and George Brown, who was by then the Foreign Secretary, should do a tour of capitals of European community countries, the idea being to test whether there was a basis for Britain to reapply. And Wilson knew very well that in five of the capitals of the six countries he would get an enthusiastic yes, and he knew that in Paris he would get something different. He didn't get from de Gaulle an absolute no, but he got polite, courteous, strong discouragement. But Wilson was clever in that when he then came back to cabinet to take a decision, so much had been invested in this tour of capitals and in the result thereof, that even those members of the cabinet who were either hostile to making an application or who were dubious about it felt that there was a greater political cost domestically in not applying than in applying, and that it was better to apply and, if necessary, face rejection than not to apply at all. So early in 1967, the British government launched a new application to join, and it's significant that it was a new application. One of the things that the Macmillan government had done, faced with de Gaulle's veto, was to withdraw Britain's application. And that was a mistake which Wilson was determined not to repeat. So even though within weeks of Britain filing its application, de Gaulle gave a very hostile press conference, Wilson had decided, and he kept using the phrase, "I will not take no for an answer," he had decided that Britain would maintain its application. It wouldn't accept no for an answer. So from a period from the spring of 67 until November 67, when de Gaulle formally vetoed Britain's application for a second time, a determined effort was made, not so much to woo de Gaulle, although that attempt was also made, but to place de Gaulle in a position where, however much he disliked Britain, it would be very difficult for him to say no a second time. And one of the reasons for Britain's not confidence, but hope that that might happen, was that, obviously, de Gaulle was that much older than at the time of his first veto. People in France were beginning to look to an era beyond de Gaulle. Secondly, in 1965, de Gaulle objecting to the increased powers of the European institutions, which were built into the Treaty of Rome on a kind of schedule of changes over a period of time. De Gaulle had withdrawn all his ministers and officials from any participation in European community events. Nothing happened in the there was an empty seat policy, and effectively for 6 months, nothing happened in the European community while de Gaulle held his partners to ransom. But in the end, they held their nerve, and de Gaulle got very little from his bullying. So there was some hope that he wouldn't again threaten to, as it were, bring the European community to its knees. Now, as it happened, de Gaulle was not a man who calculated in quite those terms, and he had no hesitation, for very similar reasons to the ones I mentioned right at the beginning, in vetoing Britain's application yet again. And a year or more went by in which the British government, faced with that veto, tried to get some purchase on how to unblock things with some help from the Germans, in particular from the then German Foreign Minister, Willy Brandt, who came up with the idea of a privileged trade agreement between Britain and the European community. But the problem with this trade agreement was the French would not agree that at the end of it would lead to membership. And although the British government was criticized by the five other members of the European community for, as they saw it, being as intransigent as the French, they were, and again rightly in my view, in no doubt that if they accepted a trade agreement with no guarantee of ultimate membership, or an association agreement which de Gaulle had offered with no guarantee of membership, then they could equally well face another de Gaulle veto or another French veto down the track, and in the meantime they would be obliged to carry out rules of the European community in which they had had no part in developing. So they resisted it. And the final kind of fling of the de Gaulle era before de Gaulle resigned in the spring of 1969, having staked his reputation on a referendum which he lost, was an approach which de Gaulle made to Christopher Soames, the former agriculture minister, who by then was the British ambassador in Paris. And de Gaulle, in a very private conversation with Soames, said that he felt that the way the European community was going was not sustainable, and that basically the organization should be run by the large member states, by France, by Germany, by Britain and Italy. And he proposed secret discussions between the British and French governments as to whether they might take this forward. The British government, scarred by previous events, reacted very, very strongly against, and I think most would now agree, mishandled it in the sense that they ignored de Gaulle's request for secrecy. They straight away briefed first the Germans and then the other members of the European community about exactly what de Gaulle had said. In so doing, they misrepresented what de Gaulle had said, saying that he wanted to dismantle NATO, whereas what de Gaulle was actually saying was that he could foresee a time in which NATO would no longer be necessary. And then the British government, the Foreign Office, on the instruction of ministers, briefed the press, giving them a blow-by-blow account of Soames' conversation with de Gaulle, which is, that's that era particularly unprecedented in the conduct of the diplomacy. So de Gaulle, of course, was furious. The French Foreign Minister told Soames that all that was left was a champ de bataille, a field of battle, and had de Gaulle not gone from power a few weeks later, then the course of Britain's attempts to join the European community would have been even more dire than it had so far been. With Pompidou came a different proposition. Pompidou was not an Anglophile in any sense. He was very much de Gaulle's protege. One of the things when you do these official histories, and you have access to the files, and because it's all paper files rather than electronic files, there are the documents chronologically on each file, and there is, in Wilson's case, in green ink, his comments. So about 2 years before Pompidou actually became president of France, de Gaulle had made a speech in which, according to the report from the British Embassy in Paris, he had effectively crowned Pompidou as his successor, as the Dauphin, as the embassy put it. And Wilson, in his green ink, wrote, "I can live with Pompidou as Dauphin. Send tennis balls?" So Pompidou was not a pushover, but undoubtedly with de Gaulle's demise, the atmosphere changed. One of the reasons why the British government had been so, Wilson in particular, and Brown had been so keen to apply in 67, was because in 69, the community was due to have a negotiation on the definitive financing arrangements of the European community. In other words, the establishment of the budget and who would pay what. And as Wilson and Brown had toured the European capitals, they had said to their would-be partners, look, the common agricultural policy is likely to be intolerably expensive for us, to which everybody apart from the French had said, yeah, but by 1969, when we have this big negotiation, you will be members, and therefore you can get things changed. But of course, by 1969, Britain was not a member. And the eventual price which Pompidou demanded of his partners for agreeing to open negotiations with Britain was that this negotiation on the financing of the European community should be completed before negotiations were opened. So Britain was presented with a situation when agreement was reached at the end of 1969 on the opening of negotiations, with a situation in which the British government calculated that on membership and by the end of the transition period, which allows you to adapt, by 1977 Britain would be making a net budgetary contribution to the European community of something like £200 million a year, which in those, at that time was a very large sum of money. But undeterred, Wilson was preparing for the opening of negotiations when in June 1970 he called a snap election based on the fact that he was well ahead in the opinion polls. And to the surprise of everybody, except so he claimed, Edward Heath, the leader of the opposition, Wilson lost, and Heath won, convincingly won. And so Wilson was out of office, and it fell to a Conservative government committed to the same policy as its Labour predecessor, to embark on the negotiations with effectively exactly the same documents that had been prepared for the Labour government being presented to the new Conservative ministers. Heath, unlike Wilson, was a convinced European of the heart as well as of the head. He had been in the army in World War II. He had travelled extensively on the European continent before the war, and he believed passionately in the mission of the European community to ensure that there was peace in Europe and not renewed war. But nonetheless, the British government faced the same kind of issues under Heath as it had faced under Wilson. And a difficult negotiation boiled down in the end to a trade-off, and it's, if you look back across the years, it seems rather incredible, a trade-off between Britain's economic interest, i.e. how much money would Britain have to pay into the European community budget on the one hand, and on the other hand, what could be done to help New Zealand butter. Now, to us now, this seems extremely arcane. But at the time, British public opinion and parliamentary opinion in the Conservative Party in particular, was extremely worked up about the issue because, for very good reasons, New Zealand had unhesitatingly come to Britain's aid in World War II. New Zealand was wholly dependent upon its exports of dairy produce and of lamb to Britain, and if Britain joined to the rest of the European community. And the French cleverly conducted the negotiations so that in the end it was a trade-off, and in order to get a reasonable deal on New Zealand, Heath had to accept a deal on the British budget contribution, which stored up problems for many years to come. And you could argue is not even resolved to this day. Look at the row that is about to happen when the European Union renegotiates its financial perspectives in the next few months. You will see this issue played out yet again. And the British government did they seriously looked at the question of whether it would be better to pull back and wait for better days. But they calculated that the dynamic line behind membership hadn't changed. In other words, there was nowhere else for Britain to go. After I've talked about the idea of a North Atlantic Free Trade Association, there was absolutely no interest in such an association on the part of the Americans, very much the opposite. And policy known as GITA, G-I-T-A, Go It Alone, was not viable. So they concluded that it was best to swallow hard. And the British negotiators inserted into the treaty documents an agreed statement which effectively said that if Britain ended up having to pay as much as the British calculated that they would have to, then something would have to be done about it. And one of the negotiators at the time, John Robinson, a Foreign Office official, described it privately as a nuclear button, that if Britain pressed the button, if it had to, there would be an explosion, and that explosion effectively happened under the Prime Ministership of Margaret Thatcher. So Britain joined the European Union at the beginning of 1973, and just to conclude on the nature of the European community that Britain joined. Was it just a trade agreement? Was it something more? The Labour Party in opposition in the early 1970s turned its face against, would have turned its face completely against membership, but was reluctantly persuaded to turn its face against the terms of membership and the price of not opposing membership altogether was Wilson's agreement that if returned to power, Labour would hold a referendum on in or out. But Wilson and Heath had Heath in 1972, just before we joined, and Wilson later, when he was back as Prime Minister after 1974, endorsed a view of the European Union, a formal view of the European Union, which had committed the members, first of all, to something called European Union, undefined by 1980, and secondly, to Economic and Monetary Union by 1980. So both the Heath government and the Wilson government of the mid-1970s were committed to something well beyond a purely trading arrangement. In the mid-1960s, when Jim Callaghan was Chancellor of the Exchequer, he went down to the Mansion House and made a speech in which he said that a single European currency might well be one of the answers to the then problems of sterling. Harold Wilson consistently said that Britain would go as far and as fast as the rest of her partners in moving towards European Union. What changed? Well, the politics, certainly for the Labour Party, changed in opposition. The European community and debate about European membership became one of the sticks with which, obviously, the opposition hoped to beat Heath into submission. And Wilson's own desire to maintain a policy of commitment to join if the terms were right was severely challenged, in particular, because in the spring of 1971, at about the time when Ted Heath went to Paris and in a famous meeting with Pompidou effected the kind of reconciliation that allowed the negotiations to be successfully concluded, at about the same time, Jim Callaghan, former Home Secretary, former Chancellor of the Exchequer, made a speech in the south of England which has become known as the Language of Chaucer speech. And Callaghan rang up at least one editor before he made the speech, saying, "You need to send somebody to report this speech because he'll be listening to the speech of the next leader of the Labour Party." Comments that were reported within 40 minutes of them being made to Wilson himself, even though Wilson was on a visit to Helsinki at the time. And what Callaghan did was to pick on something that Pompidou had said in an interview, which was that if Britain joined, he wanted to see the French language preserved. "Oh," said Callaghan in the speech, "does that mean that we can no longer use the language of Milton, Shakespeare, and Chaucer?" "Well, Mr. Pompidou, I've got an answer for you, and for greater clarity, I will give it to you in French. My answer is non merci beaucoup." And what everybody knew was, of course, that Callaghan was saying non merci beaucoup not to what Pompidou had said about the French language, but to Europe. So Wilson had to trim to preserve his leadership against threats from the Entes, and if he hadn't faced threats from the Entes, he would have faced threats from the pro-Europeans led by Roy Jenkins. And at that moment, I think, the iron entered, certainly entered the soul of the Labour Party as regards Europe. And I won't bang on about it, but Britain's first year of membership, even under the pro-European Ted Heath, was a year of controversy, not least because it concluded with war in the Middle East, and with an Arab oil embargo, and with effectively Heath at the moment, when he lost power in the 74 election, called on the basis of who governs Britain, the government or the coal miners. Heath was basically saying to his European partners, I will not agree to a common energy policy in the European community unless you give me what I am demanding, which was a European Regional Development Fund to bring money back to Britain from the amount that we paid in. So the scene was set, if you like, from then on for some of the controversies that we've seen ever since, on which happy note, I'll hand over to you.